Hi, this is Mike Ryan with TXRX. Welcome to our webinar. I'm the Director of Sales and Marketing at TXRX, and this is our fifth webinar out of nine in a series that will run through the rest of the year. This one is on milled filters. The webinar will be 45 minutes. You will be muted, so please enter your questions in the question box, and we will address those at the end of the webinar. Now I would like to introduce our presenter, Jesper Trier. Jesper is the co-founder and CTO of Combilent, our parent company in Denmark. Jesper, please take it away.
Yeah, thank you, Mike. So welcome to this webinar on milled filters. So here's the agenda for today. First, we'll show an overview of different filter types. So we are all aligned on what we mean by a milled filter. Then there'll be some general introduction to milled filters, typical use cases, the design process involved in designing a milled filter, some examples of milled filter designs that we are currently selling to various customers. We'll talk about the duplexer situation and how milled filters plays a role in duplexers. Summing up by listing advantages and disadvantages of using milled filters. So just for reference, so we all aligned on what we mean by milled filter when we talk about it in this presentation. So here's a typical filter made of individual cavities coupled with cables. In the middle, we have a typical comb line filter. So this is typically an aluminum profile which has some resonator rods screwed in. And here on the right, we have a milled filter, which is typically one big block of machined aluminum and then silver plated. So this one here is what we refer to as a milled filter in the presentation. So milled filters is not new. It has been used in the cellular market for many, many years. And our legacy at Combilent is from the cellular industry. So therefore we have been involved in the design and manufacturing of milled filters for many, many years. So we master that process from the design all through the mass volume manufacturing. The milled filter offers the advantage of being small, and also the filter is a box, which means that other components can be integrated within the filter in a nice way. The spectrum, UHF and 7800 megahertz is filling up, so good filters are needed. And by good filters, we mean low insertion loss, high rejection, high power handling, good intermodulation performance. All these parameters are needed for interference mitigation. Traditional LMR filters, as we saw on the first slide, is made from individual cavities or comb line filters. They're not usable in the multi-carrier high-power systems due to poor intermodulation performance. But by using milled filters, this issue can be overcome. So the use of milled filters is recent in the LMR industry. The typical use cases are TX post filters and RMC preselectors and duplexers, and we will show some examples here. So here's one case, which is a TX post filter. So by adding a TX post filter at the output of a combiner, it will reduce the wideband noise from the TX and allow TX and RX antennas to be mounted horizontally, like on a rooftop, and not the typical vertically tower installation. So here you see the filter, the milled TX post filter. And the requirements are low insertion loss, as it is in line with the transmit combiner. It needs to have very high power handling, as you have multiple high power signals going through it, and also low intermodulation performance, again, as you have several high power carriers going through it. And this filter is mounted in a two rack unit tray, and it also includes a frequency selective power monitor within the same tray, although the power monitor itself is not fully integrated in the filter in this case. And on the right, you see the filter curve, typical filter curve. It has a very low insertion loss in the passband, 0.1 dB, and then high rejection in the corresponding receive bands, like 40 dB rejection. Another example is the narrowband preselector filters used in RMCs. So the requirement here is different filter bandwidths, 36912 megahertz in the same form factor, having low insertion loss and high rejection close to the passband. So here's an example of RMC used together with a GTA, and the mill filter is here. And the filter curve shown here for a 6 megahertz bandwidth filter is very low insertion loss, 1 dB and 60 dB rejection very close to the passband. The design process of a mill filter is a step-by-step process. And the first one is a coupling matrix, what we call CMS simulation using software, where the input parameters are the filter requirements, such as passband, insertion loss, rejection band, and the amount of rejection required. And the output of the simulation will be number of resonators required, the resonator size, what we call the Q of the resonator, and the cross couplings in the filter, which is related to how the filter is designed. And this is called filter topology. Then we have the resonator design, which is has to be, again, using software for the power handling required from the filter. And if you have a multi-carrier requirement, then the peak power handling will be very high, and the corresponding resonator design will be there accordingly. Then the resonator material, also important. Filter is subject to in high power, which will heat up the filter. Also, ambient temperature variation has a role. So resonator material and the material of the filter housing itself is important. Then building the sample, then testing, and then if necessary, make another iteration. So here's a design example from a real filter. So it's used in Australia as a transmit filter in a combiner system. The requirements are listed here. So very low insertion loss required if used with a combiner. Very high rejection as the receive band is just 1 megahertz away from the passband. That's a very high peak power requirement, 7 kilowatt, which is coming from 11 carriers going through it, 35 watt each. And of course, it has to be PIM hardened because you have up to 11 high power carriers going through it. So this is the actual filter and the measurement of the filter. So I will show the different steps of the design. So first one is the CMS simulation. So here we enter the filter characteristics, the passband, the reject band, and the amount of isolation we need. And the output will then be the filter topology. In this case, it's a six resonator filter, and two cross couplings are required. So the cross couplings are needed in order to generate the additional notches close to the passband. So now we know the filter needs six resonators, and also there needs to be a coupling between resonator 1 and 3 and between 4 and 6, in addition to the coupling 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The next step is, here is the power calculation. You see we have 35 watt, 11 times 35. Then we have accounting for P25 phase 2 modulation, 2.6 dB peak to average. The average power will be 385 watts, which is just a sum of the, let's say, of the 11 times 35, and the peak power 7 kilowatts. And this is at ideal conditions. And below here, we take into account poor antenna return loss, or possible poor antenna return loss, which can go down to 6 dB. We don't want the filter to break down if the antenna is poor matched. Could also take air pressure, that's mounting altitude into account. Now this is calculated at sea level, and moisture and temperature and other things. So it will end up as a 19 kilowatt of peak power that we need to design this filter for. So quite a difference from the 385 watt average power to the peak power of 20 kilowatt. So this is what makes this filter difficult, is the very high peak power requirement. So here's the resonator design. We use again, we use a software, which here shows the, let's say, this cross section of the resonator, and this software can calculate the breakdown voltage based on the rotational symmetry in the calculation. And then it's an iterative process to shape the resonator with corresponding roundings. This is the tuning screw and this is the housing. So it's all about having a good distance to the housing and also to the tuning screw, and still meet the frequency required for this resonator, 425 megahertz. So here's the resulting the result of the design, and then using this resonator outline, we can build a filter. So here's some example of a filter using these mushroom-shaped resonators, and in this case, it's a duplexer, but showing the principle of different resonators. So this one here is a TX section, which has the larger resonators for low insertion loss. And the RX receive section of the duplexer for where insertion loss is not so important and power handling not important at all, but you want to have a good rejection from the receive part of the filter. So this is a good example of how to, let's say, mix different resonators within the same filter to obtain a certain performance. And then power testing. You see the filter, the Australian filter is here in the center of the picture, and all the test equipment around it. So when we have designed the filter, and of course 11 carriers at 35 watt is it will be a very large setup that we cannot easily make. So we can simulate the similar conditions using, in this case, we use 6 carriers, and each of the carriers, they have higher power. And we can also use, instead of a 6 dB load, we can use like a 3 dB antenna load. And we can also introduce a vacuum to generate the 17 kilowatt of peak power. So this is how we test the filter can actually meet the specification of this 17 kilowatt without breaking down. The filter body is the housing of the filter. This means that other functionality can be integrated inside the filter, as it is one machined housing. So you can machine different compartments from different sides of the metal block and integrate different components without any cables, just a direct connection into the filter. So all this yields a smaller total design, better RF performance, and better reliability, as you have no cables and boxes connecting. So we are using typically integration of low noise amplifiers, also power monitors, directional couplers, and the electronics associated with the power monitor. And it's also possible to integrate like isolators, hybrid combiners, and so on. And I will show some examples here. So here's one example. It's a duplexer used in a two-channel base station. So here's the two-channel base station, and the duplexer is located here, and here's the duplexer. And the schematic of the duplexer is here. It includes the duplexer itself. It has a power monitor, composite power monitor, which has a CAN bus interface. And it has a low noise amplifier integrated with two outputs. So here is the duplexer, and the low noise amplifier is shown here, which will click on to the filter, and there's a direct solder connection between the low noise amplifier and the filter. And on the other side, we have the power monitor, which also screws onto the filter, and it's everything on one board. It has the directional coupler on the one side and all the electronics on the other side, and then interface to the outside world through a connector. So we supply this filter to this type of base station, all looking the same, 20 different frequency variants, 350 to 900 megahertz, different part numbers. Another example is our two-channel duplexer. So this is shown here. Here's the duplexer, the machine, the mill filter. And you can see it's a very, very simple, very slick design. There's a tray, there's a filter box, there's a heat sink, and then there's a power supply. And here's the schematic. So it has a two-channel hybrid combiner with dual isolators. It has a duplexer, and again, it has a low noise amplifier with two outputs. So here's the inside of the box. So on one side is the filter, and on the other side, you have the isolators, the two-channel combiner, and the low noise amplifier. Everything integrated into this one unit. So again, direct solder connections between the different modules. So no intercabling, no boxes, everything inside the unit. The duplexer situation. So in the market, we see there's a general wish to use duplexers as it can save antennas. So therefore lower tower space and lower total cost of your installation. Duplexers have been used in the cellular industry for 25 years and very good results, still used in all cellular systems today. And duplexers also used in Tetra, which is also a LMR system for 20 years, also with very good results. There's a risk of intermodulation when you use a duplexer, as the duplexer is trading less tower space with lower cost and less isolation between antennas. So that's the risk here. But the duplexer can be tested. It can be built and it can be tested, and every duplexer is tested in the manufacturing process. So we know that there's no intermodulation generated from the duplexer. So in your system, when you use a duplexer and there's a problem, it's more likely from all the other system components. The entire installation aspect, like cables, connectors, surge protectors, and antennas, as many of these things are handmade on site cables, you fit connectors on site, and it's difficult to clean it and so forth. And also it's very difficult to validate the entire system as on site, as you need specialized test equipment. So we are claiming that if there is a problem when using a duplexers, it's easy to blame the duplexer, as this was the only change. We replaced two antennas, TX and RX antennas, with one common antenna and one duplexer, which we think is the wrong conclusion, as the duplexer has been tested in the factory, so we know it's not the duplexer, but something around it. So by the right approach, everything is tested carefully before installation. and you control carefully your installation, then we think that the duplexer can be widely used, at least up to six channels in existing LMR systems. Advantages and disadvantages of using mill filters. So advantages, the high level of integration, smaller and cost effective. The filter is the box, so fewer points of connections. Again, lower losses and higher reliability. Difficult filter curves possible. It's possible to introduce these coarse couplings that we saw in the beginning of the presentation, and you can mix also large resonators and smaller resonators. It can be made intermodulation hardened, which is not possible with filters made from separate cavities or combline filters. And it's also possible to die cast if you have high volume. And we typically say if you want 500 or 1,000 of the same filter, it's a valid business case to invest in a die cast tool and then get some lower price. The disadvantages of mill filters, typically it requires a continuous passband. So if you have, like in VHF systems, TX and RX frequencies mixed within the same band, it's not possible to use mill filters. So you need a good continuous passband, TX band and RX band, in order to make use of a mill filter. And also the design process, it takes a while. As you saw, it's a bit complicated with simulations and tests, and it takes time, manufacturing, machining, silver plating and testing. So typically 8 to 10 weeks is a run from starting the design until you have a filter that can be delivered to the customer. And it's a dedicated design. It's made to less flexibility. It's made to for its application. There's not much freedom to tune to another frequency or to add more rejection or have lower insertion loss or whatever. It's a dedicated design. So in conclusion, we have shown examples of mill filters, including filters having additional functionality built into it. We talked about the design process. We talked about the duplexer situation, and we also talked about the benefits and the limitations of mill filters. So we think mill filters are greatly applicable for the LMI application. And based on our history, we master the design and the manufacturing of mill filters. So if you have any requirements, please bring them forward. So thank you very much. And this is here where we will have a question and answers. And as Mike mentioned, they should be entered in the question box, and we will answer them if we can. And if not, we will let you know via email. And there's also a more question survey which you will receive immediately after this webinar close. So please fill it in. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jesper. So this is Mike. Please enter your questions into the question box. And Jesper, we have a question here. First one is, can the mill filters be modified in the field? For example,
tuned, you mean?
Go ahead.
No, typically not. I mean, they are what they are, so they can. They take special skills to, let's say, to tune them, and they cannot be modified. No, I'll say short answer is no. It is what it is.
Okay. And then the next one, do you make mill filters in the VHF?
Yeah, we have some. Yeah, it's fully possible to make mill filters in VHF as long as you have a continuous band, yes.
Okay. Thank you. Any other questions? We can stay on here for, we've got plenty of time, so feel free to ask more questions. And as Jesper said, as soon as I close the webinar, I will, you'll immediately get a link or a pop-up link on your web browser that I'm having more questions surveyed. One more question here. What is the price difference? I'm assuming price difference, you know, mill filter versus, you know, standard cavities people are used to. And, you know, and I think Jesper, feel free to jump in. I think that's going to depend upon the application and the frequencies, but anything you want to add to that?
No, I don't think you can say anything in general. But if there's a specific requirement, we can of course, compare. But again, right. It's not, I would say it's not a one-to-one comparable because of what you get. You don't get this exact same performance out of, let's say, a traditional filter made of separate cavities and a mill filter. I mean, like intermodulation, you don't get from a filter, good intermodulation performance, you don't get out of a filter made from separate cavities. So it's difficult to compare one to one. It's not really, you cannot do that easily.
Okay. And certainly if to the person that asked that question or anybody else, if you have a situation and you're wondering what the price difference is, feel free to reach out to us and we can look at it. And as Jesper said, it could vary on a case-by-case basis. Next question, is there a catalog of standard mill filter offerings? I would refer you to the catalog is essentially in two places. We have a TXRX brochure that's located on the company website, which gives a good summary of what we're doing with mill filters and our other filter offerings. But even in that brochure, it has a link to bring you to another part of the website, which will allow you to run through and see what the mill filter offerings are. And then is the filter available in 220 megahertz with a 2 megahertz transmit to receive offset?
Yeah, that's possible. Yeah, we have made some of these filters, yes.
And then another one.
I'm guessing it's a PTC application. Yeah, we have we made both variants. The one I don't recall, but the one which has 217 and 219, and the other one 220 and 222. Yeah, so if there's a special request, we have data sheets and for such filters. Yes.
Okay.
Please send your request. We can send data sheets.
Another question here, are mill filter responses of a bandpass nature or are there notch type responses possible?
Both.
Okay. And then what is the standard lead time on the mill filters?
I think we were talking about 8 to 10 weeks from we start to until we have the let's say we're able to deliver one or a few of mill filters. And okay. After that, of course, yeah. Yes. So I would say typically 8 to 10 weeks. If it's okay. A new design. If something we have already, it's less than that, but the thing with mill filters is that it's designed for the specific application more or less. So if it's so, we don't keep many different variants of mill filters in stock because they are designed for the specific application. So we don't know which one to keep in stock.
Okay. Any other questions out there? Well, we'll wait just a bit longer here. Here's one more question. How high is what is the frequency range, or how high is the frequency that this can be built for?
Yeah, what we do today is I would say VHF to 1 gigahertz, 1000 megahertz is typically the frequency range that the Combilent and TXRX is active in, but we have made filters up to 4 gigahertz. So that's, let's say, our current limit would be like 4 gigahertz for filters based on experience and test equipment and so on.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay. Well, then I'll end the webinar here. We really appreciate everybody's participation and questions. Certainly, if you have any more questions, feel free to reach out to us. When I end the webinar, again, you'll get a survey that'll automatically pop up in your browser. 4 questions, and take you a minute. We would appreciate it if you could review the survey, answer the questions, as we want to try to continually improve these webinars. But everybody, thank you for your time, and I'll end it here. Have a good day.